lead and serve the leaders to help you to be concerned about others. Give as you were giving tonight. Others. And for that reason, I want to talk about one of the leaders in the Old Testament.
Right.
I want to talk about lessons learned from a loyal leader.
All right, yeah.
Lessons learned from a loyal leader. Open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 22, if you don't mind. When we finish praying, we will read that scripture together. God, our Father, we thank you for the privilege of being in your presence and for the privilege of being in the presence of your people. We pray that you will continue to bless this convention, bless President Perkins and every member of his cabinet and every member of this convention. Bless this convention that it may continue to give glory and honor to your name and serve the needs of humankind. Bless now this moment of preaching. Glorify yourself. Honor and build up the people of God with your word. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
27th chapter of Genesis, verses 1 through 14. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, he said, here I am. And he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I will tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him. And Isaac his son, and he split the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to the young men, stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went together. But Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. And he said, look, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. And the two of them went together. Then they came to the place of which God had told him. And Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, do not lay your hand on the lamb. Do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham lifted his eyes and looked. And there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide. In the King James, it says Jehovah Jireh. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. Let us read that portion of the word. The lessons learned from a loyal leader. The Bible is replete with leaders, all kinds of leaders, all types, all shapes, all sizes, good leaders, bad leaders, backwards, foolish leaders, wavering leaders, and loyal leaders. Of the loyal leaders, none stands taller than Abraham, the first leader and the father leader for the nation of Israel. God called Abraham to lead when there was no nation. In fact, he made a covenant with Abraham to generate a nation for him to lead. In Genesis chapter 12, in that covenant pact, God called Abraham and said to him, if you will leave your father's house and country and go to a land where I'll show you, this is what I'll do for you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And in you, all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. And so the blessings of the entire global community now rested on the shoulders of this man's relationship with God. And guess what? By the power and inspiration of God, Abraham succeeded. When Paul writes about Abraham in the New Testament, he says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. Later on in that same Roman letter, Paul wrote, and Abraham did not waver at the promises of God. That is to say, Abraham, the patriarchal leader, the loyal person, was unwavering in his stance before God. And in the rest of this sermon, I simply want to lift up one episode out of the life of this loyal leader. And I want us to learn some lessons from this episode. The first lesson that Abraham, this loyal leader, teaches us is how to make a sacrifice to God. For in verse 2, God said to Abraham, take your son, your only son, your beloved son, Isaac, and go to the land of Moriah, and there sacrifice him unto me as a burnt offering on the mountain that I will point out to you. What an extraordinary request. Sacrifice your only son, your beloved son, the son of promise, as a burnt offering on the mountain where I'll point out to you. Kill your son for my name's sake. That, my dear, is an awful sacrificial request. God did not ask Abraham to sacrifice a calf or a sheep or a goat, the common burnt offerings of that day. God did not ask Abraham for a regular grain offering, the first fruits of the land. He did not even ask him for a tithe of the land or a tithe of the herd. No, God said, I want your son, your beloved son, I sacrifice him as a burnt offering unto me. God asked Abraham to do something that later on in the law, it said, was forbidden for God's people to do. Why did God ask Abraham to sacrifice his beloved son Isaac, the son of promise, as a burnt offering? God did it because God wanted to test Abraham, wanted to test his obedience, test his love, test his loyalty. God was saying, Abraham, how much do you really love me? Do you love me more than you love Isaac, your little cute boy, your beloved son, the music of your soul, the apple of your eye? Do you love me more than you love Isaac? Abraham, if you love Isaac more than you love me, Mount Moriah.
Well, well.
What a tall order.
Yes, sir.
Well, an extraordinary demand.
That's all. Yeah.
Kill this God as a burnt offering for my name's sake.
Well.
May I engage you in the text tonight?
No.
Does God require of you and me sacrifices?
Yeah.
I believe he does.
Yeah.
I believe he calls upon us to make ordinary and extraordinary sacrifices.
Yeah.
Ordinary sacrifices, time, talent, treasures.
Yeah.
He calls on all of us to make those sacrifices.
Well.
But Paul even takes it a step further. He said, not only do I want your time, that is God's hand, not only do I want your time and your talent and your treasure, but I want you.
Yeah.
So Paul writes in chapter 12 of Romans, verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren and sisters, that you present your bodies as your life, as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto me, which is your reasonable service. And then beyond that, God asks of us extraordinary sacrifices. Some in the New Testament, and even outside of the New Testament, were asked to give their lives to become martyrs for the name of Christ. You remember James was killed with the sword? You remember the young deacon Stephen was stoned to death? You remember Paul died for the cause? He was perhaps killed, as they said, on Nero's chopping block. Beheaded. Others died as martyrs for Christ.
Yes, sir.
He calls upon us to make sacrifices. Ordinary and extraordinary sacrifices. We applaud these men tonight.
Where?
On the wall back here. Wade and Williams and Willington. For the sacrifices that they made early in this convention. So that it has inspired you this day to make sacrifices, to give so that children can go to school, get a better education. May that spirit continue to permeate this convention. May it continue to permeate our National Baptist Convention. May it continue to lead us onward and upward to the glory and honor of God and for the aid of humanity.
Yeah.
And so God called upon Abraham. And Abraham teaches us the first lesson, how to make sacrifices. The second thing that this loyal leader teaches us is a lesson on how to trust God fully. To trust means to obey. And to trust God fully means to obey him. When you read verses 3 through 5, there are two illustrations in the text that I want to lift up that demonstrate Abraham's deep trust in God. The first one is, when God asked Abraham to sacrifice Isaac as a burnt offering, Abraham did not fuss with God. Furthermore, he didn't go home and get Sarah's permission, even though Isaac was Sarah's boy. The Bible said he arose the next morning and called two of his servants and called Isaac, and they went and got the donkey, and they saddled the donkey, and they went and split wood and got the wood together. And all Mount Moriah. On the third day, they arrived at the foot of Mount Moriah. And this is the second illustration of this man's deep trust in God. When they arrived at the foot of Mount Moriah, Abraham looked at his two servants and said, you all stay here at the foot of the mountain. Isaac and I, call me the lad, Isaac and I are going yonder into the mountains to worship, and we will come back. Now, let's pick at this for a minute, because there's a problem in that statement. If Abraham intends to obey God and to take Isaac to Mount Moriah and sacrifice him as a burnt offering, how in the world are they both going to come back at the foot of the mountain where the two servants are? I mean, in reality, if he can obey God, he may come back and he may bring the boy's ashes back, but he can't bring the boy back. Because God said, sacrifice him as a burnt offering, which meant put him on the altar, set the altar on fire, and burn him up. So how can you stand here at the valley, foot of the mountain, and say, the lad and I are going yonder into the mountain and worship, and we shall come back? You see, my dear, the only thing I can understand from the text is that Abraham had some profound trust in God. When God told him to sacrifice Isaac between that part and the foot of that mountain, Abraham made up his mind. I don't know how. It's not mine to say. But if God says he's going to be my son, and through him my seed is going to come, and my descendants are going to be like the stars of the heaven, the sand of the sea, I just believe if I take him on the mountain and kill him, God's got to do something about that. The man had a resurrection faith. If God has to resurrect him on the mountain, I believe God is going to do it. The man and I are going yonder and worship, and we shall come back. That's heavy faith. That's deep trust. Have you ever had to trust God like that? Let me engage you further in the text. You know what trust is in the Old Testament, particularly from the Hebrew perspective? You remember that word in Proverbs, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, lean not on your own understanding? That word, trust in the Hebrew, literally means body slam. Do a body slam. You ever seen these wrestlers on TV? They pick one of the wrestlers up and get him up there on his shoulder, slammed him to the canvas, and the announcer said he did a body slam. Well, that's what trust means in the Old Testament. Slam your body on the Lord. Put all your weight on him. Every ounce of weight you have, put it on the Lord. I remember when I was a student at American Baptist College, preacher was in preaching the God and Neighbor lecture series, and we were in the chapel listening to him preach, and his preaching had gotten juicy. And somebody in the rear of the chapel said, put your weight on it, Doc, put your weight on it. As a young student, I had never heard that statement before. And when I heard it, it resonated with me. I never heard it before, but when he said it, it resonated with me because I understood. He was saying to the preacher, I like what you're saying. I like the way you say it. Just keep on saying it. Put your weight on it, Doc. But my dear, that's what trust is. Trust is putting your weight on God. Putting every ounce that you have, lay it on God. The elders used to say in Mount Zion, where I grew up in Alabama, stretch out on the Lord. In revival, they were talking to sinners. Said, if you want to be saved, stretch out on the Lord. Put everything you got on. Trust him fully. He'll save you tonight. That's what trust is. Put your weight on God. May I ask you tonight, have you ever trusted God like that? Have you ever been on your bed of illness? Didn't know what tomorrow holds? to trust God.
Yeah.
How to put our weight on.
Yeah.
Then thirdly, he shared with us the lesson not only to help you to learn how to make sacrifices, help you to trust God, but I can help teach you that God saves.
Yeah.
Where is that in the text, Julius? He and Isaac now on their way up the mountain. As they're going up the mountain, Isaac looks over at his dad. He says, Father,
oh, yeah.
I see the wool.
Yeah. Well.
You carry some, I'm carrying some.
Yeah.
I see the materials that you're going to make the fire out of.
Well.
But, Dad,
yeah.
Where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Pain in his heart. The old man looked at his son and said, son, the Lord will provide for him a burnt offering.
Yeah, yeah.
A lamb for the burnt offering.
Yeah.
And they went on up the mountain. When they got on top of Mount Moriah, the Bible said Abraham built an altar. When they finished building the altar, he reached over and caught Isaac, pulled him to himself, and then began to tie him up. The text says bound him, tie him up, and laid him on the altar. It then quickly dawned on Isaac, I'm the answer. I asked Daddy, where is the lamb? I am the lamb. Can you imagine what was going on in that young boy's mind?
Yeah.
Can you begin to imagine how his emotions began to raise? My dad is going to kill me on this mountain. My dad is going to burn me up on this mountain.
Well,
but he didn't look. Right, every time I talk about him and Jesus now. I don't have that time. That's another sermon. Another day. Laid him on the altar. Abraham reached in his pocket or wherever he had the knife. Raised that big knife. Getting ready to stab his son to take his life. But while his hand is in the air, an angel of God speaks from heaven. Says Abraham, Abraham, don't harm the lamb. I know now that you fear me. I know now that you love me. I know now that you trust me. But God knew it already. He just wanted Abraham to know. I know I can trust you. When God had finished saying that, the Bible said Abraham turned around. When he turned around, he saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. Angel said, Abraham, go and get the ram. Kill the ram. Sacrifice him as a burnt offering.
Well.
And take your son Isaac off the altar.
Yeah.
Oh, if I'd have been there,
yes, sir.
I'd have shouted for Abraham.
Yes,
because God saved him. His precious son. He wouldn't let him kill him. He wouldn't let him burn him up. But he gave him a ram in the stead of his son. So when Isaac was taken off that altar, old Isaac could say, Daddy saved me. He was about to kill me, but the angel spoke to him, and Daddy took me off the altar. I'm saved. I was saved from a burning death. You think that's salvation? Let me take you across another way. Let's climb down Mount Moriah. And let's go down through the Kidron Valley. And let's come up on the other side. And start climbing Mount Olives. And let's turn to the right. And go to a hill called Calvary. You want to know what's Now take a seat. Not only on my Moriah do we learn the lesson how to sacrifice and how to trust God and how God saves, but come to my Moriah also to learn how to commemorate and celebrate God's blessings. For that's what Abraham did. After God had saved Isaac, after God had thrilled Abraham's heart not to kill his son and burn him as a burnt offering, Abraham was walking around with all this joy in his heart. And I'd like to believe you put it this way, I've got to commemorate this moment. And tell me, Abraham, how you going to commemorate this moment. Here's what I'm going to do, Julius. When I came here, this place, all of it was called Mount Moriah. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take a big space of this mountain, and I'm going to rename it in commemoration of what God has done in my life today, and what God has done in Isaac's life today. I'm going to rename this place Jehovah Jireh, which means the place where God provided. And I'm going to put up a sign on this mountain so that everybody else comes along, generation after generation, they'll be able to read the sign and see the sign Jehovah Jireh, and they'll know God. The way he saved on my Moriah, whenever God thrills, the way he thrilled on my Moriah, whenever God allows bubbling joy to bubble the way he did on my Moriah, it's time to celebrate God's goodness.